Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. From the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Okay, sing one more time. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to us to show the way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from, one more time, you came from. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. So today we left the name and the Spirit of Christ on high, because Jesus still enters into our lives. I told you this is the beginning of the Holy Week. For 2,000 years, countless Christians, including all of you, so many, many years, you call this week holy. It is holy because God is ready to enter into your life and into our world one more time. It is holy because God is still working to give us life that is eternally held in the love of God. God is still working to make our world as a place of peace that all God's children need. But it will not be holy if you are not ready to welcome the Spirit of God, the life of Jesus, into your hearts, into this church, and into our world. So let's close our eyes so that we can open the eyes of our hearts. Let's breathe in and breathe out. And let's leave whatever that has been occupying our hearts and our minds and our spirit so that we can create a space where the Spirit of God can come in and touch you and remake you and help you begin this week's journey. Let's worship in silence. Thank you.
Please rise as you are able. Lord God, loving friend and parent, you have entered our broken world. You have joined us on our journey of pain and pleasure, of sorrow and joy, and have opened a door, life eternal and abundant. We lift our voices to praise you, O God. We celebrate your coming to us, not with political power or military might, not with glamour or fame or wealth, but in humility and love, gently and with great compassion. We lift our voices to praise you, O God. Please remain standing. We are going to follow the choir and then sing All Glory, Laud, and Honor.
Thank you.
prayer. God, we gather on this day to begin a week of contrasts.
From the hope to despair, to the hope again.
As we begin the week, as we join with the crowd, help us to cut through the noise, to see what is happening, to see what is at stake. As the story unfolds, open us to both the hope and the suffering. In this time of worship, prepare us to celebrate, to weep, and to wait. We pray in the name of the one who not just leads the parades, but also walks the journey with us. Amen. You may be seated. The scripture today is from the Gospel of Matthew 21, verses 1 through 11. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Beit Phage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." God is still speaking. Thanks be to God.
So today marks the beginning of the Holy Week, a week that changed the history, at least up to now, for the last 2,000 years. This is the week where the Jesus life purpose and meaning comes to its climax. This is not just a week, it's a holy week, right? This is the only week that we call Holy Week with a capital H. But it's only a week. I wish it would have been Holy Year or Holy Lifetime or Holy Eternity. It's just a week. Even Jesus, even for God, time is limited. So Jesus is given a week, 7 days, but if you really think about it, only 4 days to do what we later call it the greatest things that's ever happened to human history. If you have 1 week to live, to make history, to fulfill God's grandiose purpose in your life and for this world, to change your life around and to change the world around us. And if you have 1 week to do so, what do you think that you need to do during that week? What did Jesus do on that Holy Week? Have you ever wondered what Jesus did on that Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday? And we all sort of know on Thursday, you know, Jesus did this weird thing of washing the feet and preparing a table. And we all know what happened on Friday. What made this week holy? How did Jesus fulfill his purpose? God's purpose in his life. How did Jesus change history? What did he do? Because if we know what he did on that week, chances are we can live each week as a holy week, isn't it? Because if it was holy for Jesus, and God made that week holy, then it could be so the same for us. So what spectacular, supernatural, awesome, breathtaking, super divine, holy, and sacred, and mysterious thing did Jesus do on that holy week? Let me tell you what he did on that week. First, he entered to Jerusalem, not because he had a grander plan, but because he was a Jewish man. And all Jewish men were required to enter the Jerusalem to visit the temple to offer the sacrifice on the Passover. So he was just doing what he was supposed to do as a good Jewish man. And then so he visited the temple, just like everybody else was doing it, to offer the sacrifices. And when he entered the temple on that following day, he saw something going on for that sacrifices. People were selling the doves and animals that would be bought for the sacrifices. People were changing monies that would be used for that purposes. And that made Jesus upset. And then Jesus, you all know, turned upside down those money changers' table, pushed away the benches where they were selling the animals, and then says, "You made the house of the prayer into the den of robbers." So he created some trouble. That's all. And then, most of Tuesdays and part of Wednesday, he was engaged in series of arguments and conversations with different religious leaders on the question of tax, loyalty to the empire or God, question of resurrection, question of the law, which one is the greatest commandment. He talked a lot with a lot of people who didn't like him. But he just did arguments and conversations. And in that busy argument, he had a time to observe how people give. He sat down in the temple and saw how people made their offerings and praised this widow, poor widow, who had only one coin, all her belongings to offer, and praised her. And then he taught. He taught a lot of parables on that last week, including he gave the greatest commandment to the question of which one was the greatest commandment. Love God with all your hearts, with all your strength, with all your soul, with all your mind. That's the greatest. Second is to love your neighbor as yourself, and you'll be fine. And then he visited his friends in Bethany. The scripture said he visited the Bethany, the house of Simon the leper. So this was a house where the house, probably the patriarch of the house, the Simon, who used to be leper. That's why he had a nickname leper. And they say, scholars say, maybe the Mary and Martha and Lazarus were maybe Simon's children. So it was not a mansion. It was the house where people from town would talk about, not associated with goodness, but as rumors. Oh, he was once a leper. There he received the ointment of oil, expensive oil from an unnamed woman, and got into trouble, as Judas said, why waste money on this? He was misunderstood. And then on Thursday, he prepared a meal, the last meal, the last supper, where he stood up and washed his disciples' feet. Didn't say much, just showed what it means to serve and asked them, do likewise. And right after that, he was feeling anxious about his life, So he went to Gethsemane to pray, where he said, you know, my heart is breaking apart. I'm so afraid. Asked his disciples to stay awake with him in support. And then he went to pray and deal with his God, where he was honest about his fear, his anxiousness. He says, if at all possible, let this cup pass from me. But also, as he was honest to God, he also was crystal clear about what his life was all about. He said, but not according to my will, but your will. Because my life is about you, not me. And then as he was coming down of the prayer, he got arrested. From Thursday on and until Friday morning, he faced trials, mocking, ridicules. He witnessed the betrayal of all the people whom he loved, and then his own disciples. And he had to face his own death. While also, in the midst of this suffering and mocking and betrayal and disappointment, he also prayed, even on the cross, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. He cried his own frustration, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, why God, why have you forsaken me? Even on the cross, he did his work, the salvation. He offered paradise. He offered eternal life to one of the thieves who were being crucified with him. And then he finally accepted the lot that was given to him when he said, into your hands I commend my spirit. And he died like everybody else, the Son of the Almighty God, the Savior who was supposed to restore the glorious throne of David, died like everybody else. It's like God dying like everybody else. Not just everybody else, he died on the cross as we sing the emblem of suffering and shame. And that's all. That's the content list, playlist of the Holy Week. No miracles, no walking water, no spectacular performances, no climax. Maybe that's why all those who are cheering him on this day, on Palm Sunday, turned against him. Because he missed the expectation spectacularly. That's the only thing spectacular that Jesus did on that Holy Week, that he just spectacularly missed all people's and all world's expectation of what it means to be the Savior of the world. They might have thought and believed that Jesus could do and should do what they could not do. But Jesus simply did what he could do as God's beloved Son. To love, to teach, to confront, to share the table, to suffer, to forgive, to accept, and to die. He simply did what he could do as God's beloved, for God's beloved children, at each moment of this Holy Week. Whether that meant riding on a donkey or turning upside down the tables of money changers, engaging in conversations and argument with religious leaders who were teaching the wrong gospels, whether visiting the friends and making time for them, whether creating a table and showing the example of what it means to serve, or whether showing even how to love the one who's going to betray you, and how to pray to God, not only from the place of your blessings, but also place of your questions and frustrations and despair. And he simply asked his disciples, his friends, to do the same, do likewise. To follow him as Jesus simply followed where God led him to. One day at a time. And believe it or not, that's all God needed to turn everything around. To make that helpless and missed the mark week into the greatest week. The Holy Week. That's all God needed to turn despair into hope, to break darkness with light, and to overcome death with life. And that's why this week is holy. It shows us how to live as God's children. It tells us how we can still participate in the sacred story of God's salvation and transformation and resurrection. On Thursday, I was in Flushing, New York. It was a day trip. Hurried event was formed among Korean immigrant churches, regardless of denominations in New York, to learn about how to stand with undocumented Korean immigrants. There are about, I say, 200,000 of them. And other undocumented immigrants in New York. They asked me to come and to make a presentation on what it means to be a sanctuary church. So I went there thinking that I'm just going to do the job, because it was my also duty as a Methodist pastor to offer what I have, you know, even if it's just a little knowledge or experience. And by surprise, there was a person who came to share her own story as an undocumented young person. That's all I heard, that they're going to be a witness. And when Teresa Lee, that's her picture, showed up, I was so shocked that it was her story 16 years ago in 2001. That began the whole movement called Dream Students and Dream Act. These were the people coming together. Let's give at least these children who came to our country not with their own decision, but because they were led by their parents and went through the school here. They did all the things that they could do, but still couldn't go to school or get a job because they didn't have a status. She was there. Teresa was 2 years old, 2 years old when her parents moved from Brazil to Chicago. So she has never been to Korea, actually. That was a surprise. She was 2 years old when they came to Chicago because her father was a Presbyterian minister and there was a small church that he could serve. And when they arrived, they soon realized that church was too small to be qualified as in a legitimate site to give this pastor a legal status. So soon they become undocumented. She was 8 years old when she learned that she was undocumented. They moved into this basement apartment where they didn't have any furniture. She said they slept on a hammock. And it would flood whenever there is a big, you know, rain. But her father served her church, very small church, faithfully. And one of the members who saw this family, how they loved God and how they were facing challenges, moved by God's Spirit, started to support them. So they brought them furniture. And then this person bought an old piano because they thought the children need to do something and learn something. So in this small apartment, this old piano was there. And Teresa began to play from 4 years old. She said, "I play that piano as if my life depended on it." She started being Eileen from 8 years old. Played for her father's church 8 years on. She played and prayed, and she never missed a school from kindergarten to high school or middle school. So she got an award, something like that. She was so good that the music high school recruited her with a full scholarship. She came first as a youth competition and played as a soloist with the Chicago Philharmonic, Tchaikovsky number one, when she was only, 15? By the time she was about to go to college, her music teacher approached her. "You can go any school. They will open their arms and welcome you." That's when she first came out to her teacher, said in tears, "I cannot, because I don't have a status." Even though there's no school, would not reject her, but a lot of undocumented students feel that once they go into the system, they're going to be caught, and they might be deported, or parents would be in trouble. That's why they didn't do it. She even told us a story of her younger brother who got into the accident. A car hit him. But they were so afraid that if the police is involved, then their status is going to be unrevealed. So she witnessed in young age her father telling the police it was her brother's fault, not the driver's fault, to avoid that situation. So this music teacher was asking, and she said, "I cannot go to school," in tears. And this music teacher said, "No, we should do something about this. This is just not right." And she started to make phone calls. She started to, make, questions to the immigration place. That led her to contact the Senator Dick Durbin, Senator of Illinois at that time. I knew Dick Durbin because I was involved in immigration reform in the early 2000s. He was the one who wrote the bill, first DREAM Act bill. That was the first time Senator learned about Teresa, and he checked everything, and there's no way that she could stay or she could get status. So he said, "I'm going to write this personal exemption thing." I didn't know whether there was such a thing, but he was trying to help just Teresa get temporary status. And when that effort, was spread, there were other kids who were starting to say, "What about me?" Other teachers bringing names to Senator's office. That's when he realized there were hundreds of DREAM students. That prompted him to write the legislation in 2001. On September 12, 2001, the Senate hearing was set. 60 votes was already secured. House already said yes. It was a different times. At least we can save these children. Teresa was supposed to go and play in front of senators as a witness. She bought the plane ticket, and then 9/11 came. So everything went into the smoke, and DREAM Act is still not the law. It was 2011. After 10 years, they were able to at least have a hearing where she testified. Now she is working in Manhattan School of Music on her doctorate, still playing. And She is now organizing among young people to stand with immigrants. She got her status through marriage, 2 little children. As I was listening to her story, her life is the product of Holy Week. Her life is the evidence of power of Holy Week that turned despair into hope. Not because there were great, spectacular, superpower person intervened, but because that anonymous member who wanted to do what she could do by buying old piano to these little children, because that music teacher wanted to do what she could do. She couldn't change the law, but she could write a letter. She could make a phone call. She could encourage her. And because there was a politician who wanted to listen to those voices. We need Holy Week every week. Because there are still sufferings. All these people in Syria need Holy Week. All those refugees who are floating somewhere in the ocean and all those countless camps need Holy Week. People who are fighting with the powers of addiction each day need Holy Week. Our country that is so deeply divided need Holy Week. Our churches that lost its fire for love and for justice need Holy Week. I need Holy Week each week because I need salvation each week. Our society needs reconciliation each week. Our world needs peace today, not some distant future. And friends, the good news is that God is ready to turn every week into the Holy Week. All God needs is those who want to live like Jesus, doing one act of love and courage at a time, one sharing of table at a time, one welcome of strangers and immigrants at a time, one act of service at a time, one vulnerable prayer to God at a time, one offer of forgiveness at a time, one act of sacrifice at a time. That's all God needs to make your week, my week, and every week the Holy Week. That's a spectacular good news of God. Let's stand and sing.